To use standard enthalpies of formation for calculating any reaction's enthalpy change, we need to make use of Hess's law of constant heat summation, named after Swiss-born chemist Germain-Henri Hess. Hess's law is a direct consequence of the first law of thermodynamics. It states that the enthalpy change of an overall reaction is equal to the sum of the enthalpy changes of its individual steps. In fact, it doesn't matter what route you take to get from the reactants to the products. Since enthalpy is a state function, the overall enthalpy change is independent of the path. It just depends on the state of the starting point and the ending point. There's usually more than one way to get from reactants to products. An enthalpy diagram helps to make clear how the enthalpy changes add up. The vertical axis is the absolute enthalpy, H. Scientists don't normally measure absolute enthalpy, but rather enthalpy changes, shown by arrows pointing from a system on one horizontal line to another. An upward-pointing arrow indicates a positive enthalpy change and an endothermic reaction. A downward-pointing arrow indicates a negative enthalpy change and an exothermic reaction. To make use of heats of formation, we have to break up the reaction we're studying into formation reactions and decomposition reactions. The overall reaction is the sum of the formation reactions of the products plus the decomposition reactions of the reactants. Let's look at an example, the combustion reaction between methane and oxygen to give carbon dioxide and water at 25 degrees Celsius and 1 atmosphere pressure. This overall reaction is the sum of the standard formation reactions of the products, 1 mole of carbon dioxide gas and 2 moles of liquid water. Add to that the decomposition reactions of the reactants, 1 mole of methane and 2 moles of diatomic oxygen. Actually, since oxygen is already in its standard elemental state, it doesn't contribute to the overall enthalpy change. The overall enthalpy change is the sum of the enthalpy changes of the formation and decomposition reactions. It's negative 891 kilojoules. Notice a few things here. Since 2 moles of water are formed, the standard formation reaction and the corresponding enthalpy of formation are both multiplied by 2. And remember that the decomposition reactions have enthalpy changes of the same magnitude but opposite sign as the formation reactions. Thanks to Hess's law, we can be sure that the sum of the heats of reaction of the 4 steps is equal to the heat of the overall reaction. You don't have to write out all of the formation and decomposition reactions to calculate the heat of an overall reaction. You can use a simple formula. The heat of a reaction is equal to the sum of the heats of formation of the products minus the sum of the heats of formation of the reactants. Remember that a heat of formation is multiplied by the stoichiometric coefficient of the reactant or product as it appears in the overall reaction equation. Methane is the gas burned in household natural gas furnaces. The reaction that used to take place inside a typical home gas furnace is shown on the screen. The difference between this and the reaction we looked at earlier is that the product water is a gas. Older furnaces just released water vapor to the outside air. But there's energy left to be captured from the water vapor. That's what high-efficiency gas furnaces do today. Both types of furnaces have a primary heat exchanger that transfers the heat from the main combustion reaction where both products are gases. But high-efficiency furnaces also have a second heat exchanger, where gaseous water condenses into liquid water. That simple reaction releases more heat. The difference in delta H between the efficient and inefficient reactions is equal to the enthalpy change of the condensation of the 2 moles of water, negative 88 kilojoules. The condensation reaction adds over 10% to the heat energy yield of the efficient furnace.